Hi, everyone. First of all, I just want to say thank you so much to Peg for, I mean, who gets a crowd like this to a literary event? You know, I mean, it's just, hey, it gives me so much hope for humanity, so yeah. Thank you to the gallery, thank you to Why There Are Words in general, and especially to all of you for being that community who shows up. It's really amazing, so thank you for being here. The name of my novel is The Evolution of Love. Somehow I came up with the chutzpah to write a novel in which most of the characters are asking the question, what is love? I got to this place out of basically a deep despair. I've been looking around the last few years, basically, not even just the last year, at humanity, and just really wondering, is there hope for us as a species? And what is love? And I feel a little bit like my mind is like a cell phone circling around looking for a signal. You know? But it's finding little bleep, bleep, bleeps in places like this and where community does come together. So I wanted to, I started reading history and thinking, well, there's no hope in history because humanity's always been messed up. But then I started thinking about human evolution as opposed to recorded history. And what if our capacity for compassion and cooperation and altruism were traits that in the evolutionary long run won out over greed and animosity and its corollaries. And that would be a timeline we can't see because we're, you know, in such a small piece of it. But what if in the evolutionary history of humanity, those people were more successful? So I wanted to write a novel about that. As I say, this time calls for big questions. So I wanted to take a community and put a big stress on them and see how that community responds. So I gave them a big earthquake. And I want to introduce you, basically the theme of body language is basically my entire novel. I'm asking what is stored in our DNA, and is what is stored in our DNA, will that save us? So I just want to introduce you to three of the characters in this novel, starting with the very first few paragraphs of the novel. Where my character Lily has just arrived. The earthquake took place 10 days prior. She lived in Nebraska, but she hasn't heard from her sister who lives in the Bay Area since the earthquake. So Lily has decided she's got herself out in the Bay Area and she's going to look for her sister, Vicky. Lily jumped down into the earthy crevice that split the freeway. The dirt smelled metallic and organic like a grave, and she quickly hoisted herself out the other side. She began walking west. All the refugees had walked in the opposite direction, leaving the region. She'd seen them on TV, the network reporters flying low in helicopters, filming the streams of people carrying children, pushing shopping carts, rolling suitcases, lugging pet carriers, and riding bicycles. Now, 10 days after the earthquake, the freeway was deserted. She'd told herself, and she had told her husband Tom, that she was coming to rescue her sister Vicky, and she was, she would. She'd been rescuing her sister her entire life. But she'd never done anything remotely this extreme. She knew that the region had been evacuated, yet somehow hadn't pictured everyone literally gone. She'd greatly underestimated what she'd need for food and water. The stark, devastated landscape heightened all her senses, as if her fear made the colors deeper, the smells headier, and the sounds crisper. She couldn't give in to the terror, though. If she did, it might never end. She had no choice now but to finish what she had begun. Lily checked her phone and confirmed that the battery was indeed dead. She was severed from Tom, from Nebraska, from home. She was entirely alone on the wrecked highway with big green hills to the east and a giant bay to the west. Heat shimmered off the pavement. The air sat perfectly still, a hot blue sky await. The sun arced toward the western horizon as if rushing away from disaster, but not her. Lily scuffed along toward the devastation. So I can't write about human evolution without, of course, bringing in bonobos. Who knows what bonobos are? Usually it's about 50%. They're a primate. Only a tiny population of them still lives in the Democratic Republic of Congo. They used to be believed to be a kind of chimpanzee, but they're not. They're their own primate. And they have a wonderfully astonishing culture. They're matriarchal. They're incredibly compassionate within their societies. They take care of their elders. Infanticide is unknown among bonobos. They cooperate. They share food. It's just kind of amazing. And as it turns out, everyone knows that we're 98-point-something% descended from chimpanzees. We are equally descended from bonobos. So we have all of those traits in it. So this supports my idea that perhaps those traits, despite this poor primate having only a tiny population left, there's a huge population of us, and we have that in us. Anyway, so I'm going to introduce now in these few paragraphs my character who's a bonobo researcher. The character you just heard, Lily, was assigned to get a pen pal when she was in eighth grade, and she started writing this guy in the Democratic Republic of Congo who's researching bonobos, and this is about her relationship, the beginning about her relationship with him. In his first letter, 20 years ago, Travis had explained all about the bonobos. He had written that hope for humanity was dependent upon our understanding of this dwindling species. Thrillingly, he had told her that she, Lily Jones, had a role to play. It was people like her, quote, an ordinary girl from Nebraska with no particular passions, close quote, who would change the world or not. She'd read that letter maybe 100 times, and her understanding of his meaning as well as her response to that meaning kept changing over the years. At first, at that age of 13, when she was just stepping beyond girlhood, she felt seen. Growing up in her sister Vicky's shadow, she'd never considered the possibility that being ordinary could be a good thing. Already 5 feet, 8 inches tall, gangly and gawky, wanting bright blue rather than gray eyes, plump lips rather than thin ones, a pert rather than Roman nose, the idea that she might have a role in world transformation, that her very ordinariness could be useful, riveted her. She wolfed down every word, phrase, sentence, paragraph of Travis's. She wanted to hear more, much more. Later, in her early 20s, she felt not seen. Yes, she was ordinary. She embraced ordinary. She married Tom for ordinary. And yet she did have strong feelings. She had particular passions. She wrote to Travis about them. She wanted him to know what she loved. Sometimes she resented the way he seemed to want to use her as a blank canvas for his ideas. Then a few years ago, she let go of worrying about how he saw her altogether. What did it matter? He was a few thousand miles away. She loved his dedication to an ape in the Congo. She admired his gigantic life. Sure, he could be self-involved, but Travis was a window to the world beyond, and Lily had gazed and gazed and gazed. How strange to think that he, too, might now be in Berkeley, California. I'm going to read one last excerpt, and this introduces another character in the book. When Lily gets to Berkeley, basically, she finds a free meals program in Trinity Church. Trinity Church actually has a free meals program. I used to volunteer there. These are fictional characters, of course. And Kalisha's a woman who has been running the free meals program for years, long before the earthquake. She was a PhD candidate in philosophy at Cal until she got into a little bit of trouble, which I will explain in this passage. This is a little history on Kalisha, who's a major character in the book. Her boyfriend at the time of when she was studying was Michael. Michael and she were the only two black students in Cal's graduate program in philosophy. They knew others expected them to hang out together, to have lots in common, and so they avoided each other at first. She thought he was a little pompous with his outsized afro, high water slacks, and persistent scowl, as if to make clear that he was always deep in thought. But she soon learned that he was always deep in thought. It took about 2 months for them to fall in love, and it was a love Kalisha had thought she'd never have, a man who respected her intelligence, who wanted to ask the biggest questions in the universe. Their most pressing, practical problem was figuring out how they would find jobs at the same university, because no one was going to hire 2 African-American philosophers in the same place. In their second year, they dropped acid together. Most students of the mind do so at some point in their studies. It was fascinating to consider the frontiers of brain chemistry. And oh my, the universe they viewed. They believed they actually saw the colors and shapes of justice. Seeing that ideas could take on physical attributes moved them so deeply that they took a course in art history as well. Moving on to trying heroin, they always called it that back in the beginning, not dope, not smack. They were PhD candidates at a prestigious university, after all. Was not so common among their peers. It was a dangerous drug. She and Michael knew that, but it never, not once, occurred to her that there was something she couldn't do, that she would lose control. They experimented together 2x. Making love while high was like swimming in the purest form of joy. Afterward, she experienced a quality of peace like none other. Michael never used again. For him, the experience had been clinical research. He knew any further use could be deadly. Of course, Kalisha knew that too. Yet she sought out and used the drug a couple more times without him finding out. It was impossible to hide the needle marks for long. Kalisha used to be very angry at how quickly he jumped ship. He suggested she get help. He gave her the contacts for a couple of programs. Then he distanced himself from her in every imaginable way possible. He slammed the door shut hard. By the time she was busted, she had already dropped out of the graduate program. You couldn't exactly teach undergraduates, read hundreds of pages a week, and write a PhD thesis while high. She went to jail for 2 years. Of course, any white girl in a PhD program at the University of California would not have gone to prison, but her family in Chicago had no money to pay for lawyers, and anyway, she'd been too ashamed to ask them for help. Her doctoral advisor, Professor Vernadsky, did everything he could. He made phone calls, he hired a lawyer, he testified on her behalf in court, but it's possible that his involvement did more harm than good, given his eccentricity. But Kalisha loved him for trying. Professor Vernadsky wrote to her the entire time she was in prison, every single week. He wrote about what he was reading and how his philosophical views were changing. He'd quote Aristotle, the bits about the first condition for the highest form of love being that a person loves himself. How without an egoistic basis, a person can't extend sympathy and affection to others. How self-love is not about glorifying oneself or indulging pleasure. How it's about reflecting on what is noble and virtuous, how the reflective life is the highest form of self-love, and also the first step toward loving others. Professor Vernadsky managed to convince Kalisha that prison afforded her a small glimmer of opportunity because there she could reflect to her heart's content. His letters saved her life. Thank you.